America is essentially a dream.
Good evening and welcome back to Network X. I'm your host tonight, Peter Hart. Tonight we're going to be discussing Initiative 297, an initiative to try to stop the illegal dumping out at Hanford and to help stretch out the process of cleaning that and determine whether or not there's actually a culture of cleaning going on at Hanford at all. To help us do that tonight, we have Heart of America Northwest, Gerald Paulette. Gerald,
Hi.
Welcome to the program. Thanks for coming tonight.
Oh, it's great.
So let's start out in just describing what led to this initiative process. Why did you and GAP, Government Accountability Project, feel that the initiative process was the best strategy at this point?
The coalition of Hanford public interest groups has been working for years to stop the dumping of nuclear waste in unlined trenches at Hanford. And this year, well, a year ago about this time, the Department of Energy announced that they were going to start shipping plutonium waste to Hanford. And they also had a plan to make Hanford a national radioactive waste dump to ship 70,000 truckloads of radioactive waste to be dumped in the soil at Hanford. And much of this waste will come from new nuclear weapons production. Unfortunately, Washington state officials at the Department of Ecology, after many hours of negotiation face to face with our coalition, said that they were not going to stop the shipment of nuclear waste and the dumping in unlined trenches. And that left us little alternative except to go to federal court and to file an initiative. We did go to federal court, and Attorney General Chris Gregoire went to federal court at the same time to block shipments of plutonium. We're talking about highly radioactive, deadly plutonium mixed with chemicals that would be on trucks going up Interstate 5 through the Portland area, over the Blue Mountains of eastern Oregon, and through downtown Spokane on Interstate 90 with no precautions. And a federal judge agreed with us and said, you can't ship these particular shipments until you do an environmental impact statement. The Department of Energy is scrambling to put that out, and suing over 70,000 truckloads is like having to sue 70,000 times. The answer here is to change state law and say you can't add more waste to the most contaminated place in the Western Hemisphere until it's cleaned up. And that's what Initiative 297 will do.
Okay, so to make that actually illegal. There's already a problem out there that your initiative also addresses, and that's the dumping that's going on into unlined trenches. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Well, it's crazy. In this day and age, the federal government still dumps the most dangerous waste on Earth into unlined soil ditches that we know will contaminate the Columbia River. And so you and I can't dump our kitchen garbage out the backyard in an unlined ditch. City of Seattle can't dump municipal garbage in an unlined landfill. And yet the Department of Energy every day takes radioactive waste and dumps it in unlined soil ditches. Some of them are 3 football fields long.
We actually have, I think, a couple of pictures. Maybe we can get those up on the screen. For those of you just joining us, again, Hanford is the largest production facility for the weapons-grade uranium and plutonium.
That's right.
In the Western Hemisphere, clearly.
Right.
And it's now, of course, that makes it the the residents of the, there we go, up on the screen there, you can see if you can describe that for us, Jerry.
Well, this is a great photograph of what is probably the smallest of all the radioactive waste dump trenches at Hanford. It was taken by my colleague Tom Carpenter, who runs the whistleblower and nuclear programs at the Government Accountability Project. And it's a recent photograph of radioactive waste dumped in an unlined trench. There are barrels, there are filters that are probably contaminated with plutonium. There are, you know, you can see, they don't know where any particular barrel is in this trench. And imagine this, this is one trench, but there are trenches that are 1,000 feet long, just like this. And then there are others in which they are actively putting in more plutonium waste that they're trying to import.
There's the other, the second image we have.
This is an older burial ground showing the condition of what happens to the barrels after a not very long period of time. You know, this waste is going to migrate through the soil and will be dangerous for hundreds of thousands of years. And you can see it doesn't take very long to have a barrel disintegrate. One of the most shocking things out at Hanford is that these burial grounds have been found to start leaking within 20 years. And right now we have barrels of waste that are seeping out deadly carbon tetrachloride, which is both a poison, a reproductive carcinogen, and it's something that goes both into the groundwater and up into the air. And the vapor level in the air in the trench is at 170 times what OSHA says is safe for a worker to be exposed to. It's nearly at the level that we know kills people. And this is a trench where the Department of Energy, right next to it, has another trench that they're actively adding more waste to.
And again, these are unlined trenches, so in addition to this waste being exposed to the atmosphere, it's also leaching down into the ground and possibly the groundwater
through the vadozone. Right. We know it's reached the groundwater from these trenches, carbon tetrachloride, and we know that it is an urgent and imminent threat to the health of the workers who are being told to dump more waste in the trenches next door to it. And we're talking about each trench being separated by maybe 10, 15 yards.
And again, and when we're talking about the water out there, we're basically talking about the Columbia River. This is south central Washington, where that bend in the river wraps right around this nuclear production reservation. Well, it's no longer, I suppose, a production facility, but it's where everything's being stored.
Yeah, the
decommissioned.
If people aren't familiar with the Columbia River in that part of the state, the Hanford Reach of the Columbia River flows through the Hanford Nuclear Reservation for 50 miles. So we have 50 miles in which the contaminants are flowing into the river. And we have 9 nuclear reactors lining the river for plutonium nuclear weapons production that are now shut down. Then there's the FFTF reactor that we just won after 7 years, a fight to shut down. And there's a commercial nuclear reactor. But in the soil, seeping into the through the banks of the river in what is now a national monument, are levels of strontium-90, which is radioactive, levels of carcinogens and toxic chemicals seeping out into the riverbed and into the shorelines where people are now being encouraged to go as a national monument. It's the only national monument that is too contaminated for safe public use. And one of the other shocking things is that, of course, there are 3 tribes with a treaty right to live along and fish at the usual and accustomed places along the river. It's the last natural breeding ground for Chinook king salmon on the main stem of the Columbia River. And we're poisoning the salmon, and we'll be poisoning Native Americans or other Americans who fish and try to use the national monument there.
How are they getting away with this? How does the Department of Energy not have to abide by these laws of, you know, dumping, you know, dangerous materials into the ground?
Well, our view is that federal law gave the state of Washington very clear authority to stop the dumping of any waste into the ground where the ground is already being contaminated. And our state simply is refusing to use that authority. Initiative 297 would essentially say, we're taking that authority, state law will simply ban the dumping of waste into the soil wherever you already have a Superfund toxic waste site where the waste is entering the river or entering the groundwater or entering the air. And that just makes common sense. We all learned in kindergarten, you got to clean up your mess before you take out more toys. Well, you've got to clean up Hanford before you get to add more waste. And unfortunately, at the pace the Bush administration wants to clean up Hanford, I won't be around to see the end of Hanford cleanup. But they want to add 70,000 truckloads more of radioactive waste.
Is there a political element to this? Is the Bush administration, do you think, because they didn't receive enough electoral support from Washington and Oregon, do you think there's a kind of a punishment going on here or a payback of some kind?
I think that's a very fair and good question. Clearly, the Bush administration feels that Washington state's and Oregon state's opposition to being used as a nuclear waste dump can just be ignored. That the one congressman from the Tri-Cities, Doc Hastings, refuses to support any legislation to end the dumping of waste in unlined trenches. And with that kind of support, the Bush administration appears to say, we're going to write off Washington state. If they do want to win votes in Washington, they'll have to come out here and campaign at the same time. This initiative is on the ballot.
There's been a tremendous amount of money affiliated with Hanford right since its beginning as a production facility during the Manhattan Project. And today, I don't know what the annual budget is today, but is it roughly $2
billion? $2 billion a year. It's the largest public works project in America.
Has there been any progress in creating a culture of cleanup out there? I mean, it seems like the people that are opposing it, part of the reason why they're opposing it is because they think they're going to be losing this cash cow that existed for so long. Is that part of the mentality out there? I mean, why can't they make money off the cleanup as well, is what I'm getting at.
Well, I think people are getting rich off the cleanup, and it is the one area of our state's economy, actually, that is booming, the Tri-Cities, because of the dollars flowing into Hanford for cleanup. There is progress on the cleanup front, not nearly the progress one would expect from $2 billion a year being spent. A lot of that money is supposed to go to cleanup and doesn't. In the Tri-Cities, we find a lot of people who are opposed to being used as national radioactive waste dump. It's the contractors who work for the Department of Energy and their economic influence. They want to see Hanford as a national radioactive waste dump. It's not only in their interest right now today, but they feel that if they're operating other Department of Energy nuclear weapons plants, they need a place to dump their waste. And so they have a very powerful interest in trying to stop what we, the citizens of the state, are trying to do, which is clean up first, not add waste.
Where has the support for this initiative come from politically so far in the state or in the region?
Well, let me start with, in the region, we've had this terrific support from Congressman Jay Inslee, Congressman Adam Smith, Congressman Jim McDermott, Senators Ron Wyden and Maria Cantwell, all of whom have worked with us to develop legislation to ban the dumping of radioactive waste in unlined ditches this year. I should also say we have that has the support of Patty Murray, as I understand it. And they have introduced a bill in the House to ban dumping of unlined waste, waste in unlined ditches by the end of 2003. Congressman Inslee took that to the House Rules Committee to make an amendment to the defense bill this year. And ironically, Congressman Hastings from the Tri-Cities was sitting in as the chair of the Rules Committee. And Congressman Hastings held a vote on it, and he voted against having this become law and blocked it from being added to the defense authorization. So we have a recorded vote there, and unfortunately not one of the three Republican congressmen, congresswomen from Washington State would sponsor the bill to ban dumping of radioactive waste in unlined trenches. It's very sad. In Oregon last year, when we began to make a political issue out of the truckloads of radioactive waste proposed to come through Oregon to be dumped at Hanford, at first there was pressure on Senator Gordon Smith, who was up for re-election, to have him support the Bush administration. And there was such an outcry that Gordon Smith had a great letter sent to the hearing on the proposal saying, stop the trucks from rolling through Oregon, don't use Hanford as a waste dump, stop dumping in unlined trenches. And I think that that is the sense of anyone, whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, you look at this and say, this is crazy, and it's a question of what other political pressure makes you take a different position.
Well, let's follow up on that. What do you think? Is it a question of following the money here for the Republican representatives, or?
Well, I think it is both a matter of economic self-interest for someone like Congressman Hastings and following the Bush administration. He is, you know, I think the most closely allied with the administration position on everything of any member of the delegation. And perhaps one of the most in the entire Congress. And so he's not bucking them and is supporting them. And we've sat in his office, and he's looked us in the eye and said, well, some in the Tri-Cities would say that it's economic development to take the nation's nuclear waste and bury it. It's not much economic development. One accident, of course, would shut down the economy of the entire state. And it's not economic development when we're talking about producing maybe 50 to 100 jobs. The rest of Hanford cleanup produces 14,000 jobs.
So there's plenty of money there to maintain that level of employment for the basic cleanup that needs to go on. And what Hastings or others that are supporting that, the additional waste coming into the state, it's really, you know, in terms of the overall benefits, it's not that much, what you're saying.
Well, it is not a jobs issue. It's not going to produce jobs. It robs money from Hanford cleanup, so it actually robs us of jobs. It's about some contractors' private self-interest and helping them. And it's about the nuclear weapons complex being able to dump. The plan is that they would keep Hanford operating as a radioactive waste dump through the year 2046. So all those promises that Hanford's going to be cleaned up by 2028 or 2035, whichever claim you believe that they put out each day, they're not telling the truth when they then have a plan to keep operating Hanford as a radioactive waste dump through 2046.
Can you pursue this a little bit further? The money, who are some of the companies that we're talking about, the contractors that are out there today that are going to benefit or have been benefiting from the cleaning up that goes on out there? Yeah.
It's ironic. Most of the so-called cleanup is being done by the same companies that are also operating the nuclear weapons production facilities around the country and operated Hanford in the past, or successor companies. And so you've got For instance, Fluor Hanford Company, a subsidiary of Fluor out there, Bechtel. Bechtel has a subsidiary called Bechtel Hanford. You have a subsidiary called Bechtel National. They are partnered with British Nuclear Fuels. One of those funny little asides is that the recently just passed president of Fluor Hanford recently married Congresswoman Jennifer Dunn of Bellevue. These companies have a great deal of influence both, I think, in this state and, of course, nationally. You look at Bechtel, look at the Iraqi recovery plan, and these companies were right there as well, without competitive bidding and all the same type of problems you have with contracts at places like Hanford.
So they're very vertically integrated in terms of the economic benefits that they can derive from a place like Hanford, as well as politically, it sounds like.
Right. If you operate and want to keep operating a nuclear weapons production facility and you see your future revenue stream there for 20, 30, 40 years, then your cleanup arm that operates at Hanford is going to be driven to operate Hanford as a national radioactive waste dump. Hanford is just kind of the place where you can train people, then farm out somewhere else. It's a place where the contracts allow you to have massive numbers of people on staff who then get to go to other projects. It's really not much change from the notion of a cost-plus contracting era.
The Bush administration has been moving towards a new generation of nuclear weapons. How does that relate to all this in terms of the influence you think might be cast on the contracting out at Hanford and the decisions to bring more waste into a facility like Hanford?
Well, we know, for instance, that at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, there are barrels of transuranic plutonium waste that are sitting out under tents. And the state of California has said, unless you clean this up, we're going to shut down your new weapons development, which is what is creating this waste. Well, guess where it's going to come? Hanford. And that's, you know, a major driver. The nuclear weapons production complex, most people think, gee, I thought we were getting rid of nuclear weapons. Well, we're not. We're not even getting rid of the weapon core. We're just taking them apart and storing them and modernizing them, developing new weapons at the same time. And the Bush administration is spending billions of dollars on what they call stockpile stewardship, which is a modernization program, another set of billions of dollars on programs to test weapons, including they're proposing to resume the ability to do underground testing of nuclear weapons at the Nevada test site. All of which, all these programs, of course, create the waste that has so contaminated Hanford.
We're down to about 5 minutes or less. Let's focus in a little bit more on the initiative that you and GAP have started, and your hopes are to get this on the 2004 ballot in November of 2004, correct?
Right. We're collecting the signatures throughout the rest of 2003. We hope to have it done by the end of November 2003, 250,000 signatures. So we need a lot of people's help.
A voluntary effort, I'm assuming?
We're mailing them to our membership. We've got a very big coalition building. It's not just Government Accountability Project and Heart of America Northwest and our 16,000 members, but we've got the endorsement of the Sierra Club Cascade Chapter, Physicians for Social Responsibility is a core group. We've got the endorsement of the Washington Environmental Council, Columbia River Keeper, and the list is growing literally every day. And Within a month, it'll be three times that size as more and more organizational boards endorse and participate. It's very exciting. People really want to be a part of the campaign. And collecting 250,000 signatures is, I tell you, quite an organizing endeavor. We were talking before the show that we need to make 40,000 phone calls to recruit people to get out there.
That is a tall order, but well worth it, clearly, for the health of this state. And the area that, of course, we're talking about, South Central Washington, or Southeastern Washington, depending on your sense of geography. That's like a major breadbasket for the country. And sure. There's a lot at stake here. And that's something that you don't see talked about much in the major media, if at all, I suppose. So we hopefully will be seeing people out at all the street fairs throughout the rest of the summer, hopefully bumper shoot, that kind of thing, trying to collect signatures for 297.
Absolutely. You'll see people out. And what we really want to encourage are people to go to www.protectwashington.org and www.heartofamericanorthwest.org and ask to get some petitions or volunteer. You know, come and volunteer to go to an event. We're asking people to agree to fill out one petition sheet. We've got one right here that we've started right here. Fill out one every week with your friends, relatives, neighbors, and mail it in, and we'll mail you another one.
We've got two web addresses up there on the screen, Heart of America Northwest and Whistleblower. That third one, though, is www.protectwashington.org, all one word there, protectwashington.org. Okay,
and
for more information.
Yeah, going to the Government Accountability Project website or Heart of America will get you there, too.
Okay, great. Jerry, thanks very much for being our guest tonight on Network X. We really appreciate all your efforts in trying to make the state of Washington, particularly South Central Washington, a healthier and safer place, not only for those that work there, but for those that have lived out there for generations. Thank you all for joining. Please stay informed and get involved. This is Network X. Have a good evening.
Just enough to scare.